Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Rogue Angel by Alex Archer. Rogue Angel number 47. River of Nightmares. Narrated by Nanette Savard. With performances by Colleen Delany, Richard Rowan, David Jourdan, Tim Carlin, Andy Brownstein, Yasmin Tuazon, David Coyne, Laura C. Harris, Tim Getman, Christopher Scheeren, James Lewis, Sasha Olinick, Eric Messner, Kenyatta Rogers, Michael Glenn, Jefferson A. Russell, Nora Achrati, Gary Tells, Terence Aselford, and Ken Jackson.
The beast followed the river, staying well back from its edge. Mysterious and hiding all manner of scaly creatures within, the river was the center of her world. Her life, all life, was tied to it, and she knew that to venture too far from it, too deep under the layers of leaves where the shadows forever ruled, was to risk captivity and death. The shadows were the domain of men. The beast waited to drink until she reached a spot where a stream fed into the great river. She trusted this thin water, as she could see to its bottom, and could stand in it without worry. It flowed around her massive three-toed feet and made her happy. On a bright day like this, the beast could admire her reflection. She resembled both monkey and sloth, front legs longer, back sloping, and all of her covered with thick, matted fur, the skin beneath tough like an alligator's. Her snout was long and beautiful and filled with tiny sharp teeth that could easily puncture flesh. But the beast ate fruit and leaves only. At times, though, she would tolerate the friendly dawn-colored fish that could at night become men, or rather, something like men. They would sit on the bank and sing, and she relished the melody. And sometimes she would get quite close to a river creature that looked like a child, but was not. It had backward feet, and the beast had watched this creature lead hunters to their doom. The beast had not seen the backward one in some time, and wondered if perhaps the creature was dead. She had, however, in these recent days, seen more and more men come to the river to fish and hunt. They had tried to catch her. Others of her kind had been caught in the past. The foul men had tugged her sisters through the forest. She'd followed them once. The men kept her kind in little villages and had forever stolen their freedom, making them carry things upon their broad backs. She worried that someday enough men would find her and that they would not fear her stench and would tug her to one of their villages deep under the layers of leaves where the shadows always ruled. But for now, she brushed the troubling thoughts away and continued to follow the river, admiring the bright colors and musical sounds that the great forest gave her this fine morning. Rue felt old today. He was a tall fellow of moderate affluence, white hair draped past his shoulders, neatly trimmed beard edging just below his Adam's apple, gray suit well tailored, and light blue shirt nicely pressed. A retired farmer, perhaps, likely in his late 60s or early 70s, who'd come to visit the big city. His skin had that look, like a worn piece of leather weathered by the sun and the wind, his fingers calloused. He was, in truth, more than 5 centuries old, and his vocation had been swords rather than plowshares. As he stared at the rising spires of Cathédrale Notre-Dame de Rouen, he swore he could feel every one of those years pressing down on his shoulders. One entrance of the cathedral was framed by a 740-ton work of art, illustrating the martyrdom of St. John the Baptist. The main door depicted Jesus' family tree. The other entrance was dedicated to St. Stephen, considered the first martyr. No tribute to St. Joan here, and she had been, in Rue's estimation, the most noble and sacrificing of all of Christendom's martyrs. But she would not have approved of the ostentatious pomp this cathedral displayed. Joan had been a rather humble soul. Like the years, the thought of her weighed heavy on him this day, May 9th. There were plenty of tourists in such a picturesque setting as Rouen. Rue had walked these streets when the city was greater. It had been second only to Paris until the 18th century. It was a place of wealth and power then because of its impressive wool industry. Later, the Normans named it their capital. William the Conqueror had called it home. Rue had too, for a brief time. Rue had been back numerous times since then, the last in the late 1980s when a storm toppled one of the cathedral's pinnacles. The choir stalls and vault were damaged too. He thought the cathedral's interior, with its vibrant stained glass, was even more impressive than the outside, and that was where he'd intended to pray this morning. He changed his mind. He made his way to around the side and to the back of the cathedrale. Here he faced the Palais de l'Archevêché, the Archbishop's Palace, where Joan had been tried in 1431 and rehabilitated posthumously there 25 years later. She had been captured, accused of heresy, but Rue knew it was all politics. Condemning her was merely an attempt to undermine her king. The trial began in January and took a winding course before the unfortunate but inevitable end. May 9th stuck in Rue's mind because he'd been in the castle of Rouen trying to visit her that day, but had been denied. He had a plan to break her out. That day she'd been threatened with torture lest she decry the voices and yield to the city's clergy. Rue had made it as far as the prison tower and was close enough to hear her screams of refusal.
Je refuse! Je désavouerai tout ce que vous me ferez dire!
Always so strong of mind and body. I'll never forget her words.
Sometimes Rue came to Rouen in May to pay his respects to Joan, though sometimes he purposely stayed away because the memories were too thick here. He'd been one of Joan's knights, and he had failed her. Unable to save her, he witnessed her horrific burning. He'd shared a special connection with the Maid of Orléans. And now he had a different connection with Anya Creed, the woman who'd inexplicably inherited Joan's sword. Today he was here for Anya, not Joan. He'd thought, sensed, that Anya was here, and he'd sensed serious trouble brewing. But something was wrong with his thinking. She was nowhere in Rouen, or in France for that matter, and the special connection they shared, and that somehow usually let him know where she was, at this moment had become a frayed thread that stretched to where? Rue's dreams the past several days had been troubling. Anya's and Joan's faces had been merging, one woman interposed over the next, and Anya's form becoming more indistinct with each passing night. Merely dreams, or some sort of omen? He wasn't responsible for Anya. He had his own life, filled with the simple pleasures of young women and fast cars, and only occasional complexities. But he was tied to Anya, somehow, and maybe his future was linked to hers. Rue enjoyed his immortality, but once in a while, genuine worry crossed his thoughts. After Joan's death, her sword had shattered and seemed lost to the ages before it mysteriously reformed and landed in the grip of Anya Creed. If Anya died, would Rue age like a normal man? He wasn't obliged to look out for her, but perhaps she was responsible for his continued existence. Where was she? He walked the streets, alternately musing about Joan and Anya, eventually arriving at Vieux Marché, where Joan had been tied to a pillar and burned to death. He sat on a bench and tipped his face up to the sun, reached in his pocket, and pulled out a phone. Rue didn't call Anya often. He didn't want her to think he was checking on her or meddling. Today, it was to ease his soul.
Hi, this is Anya. Please leave a message and I'll get back to you.
Ah, drat.
Your call has been forwarded to an automatic phone message system.
Anya Creed
is not available.
Ah.
He used the number for her satellite phone.
Hello? Rue?
Anya, where are you?
In Belém.
What? Did you say Bethlehem?
No. Though in a way I did. Belém. It means Bethlehem, but it's in Brazil. What's this about, Rue?
I am in Rouen, and I was thinking of you.
Listen, we landed about a half hour ago and we're waiting for a van. I'm in the country for 3 weeks. So when you're thinking about me, think about little biting insects. I've been told to expect a lot of them. We're filming a series for...
Chasing History's Monsters.
I'm pretty busy here, Rue. We have to get to our boat.
This boat,
O Seguro. It's Portuguese, means the dependable boat. And my crew is depending on me to keep us on schedule. So, do you need something? Is anything wrong, or... Ned, don't leave your bag just sitting there! Ned! Sorry, Rue, didn't mean to shout in your ear.
Nothing's wrong. I was just thinking of you, that's all. Be well, Anya.
Sure, Rue, I will. Bye.
She sounded well, but the connection he felt, the thread that somehow let him know where she was, he still couldn't feel it. He used his phone to look up Belém, discovering that it was a large port city in Brazil with a 5-hour time difference. It had been just shy of 8 o'clock a.m. there when he'd reached Anya. He would get some lunch and ask the waitress if she knew of any good travel agencies nearby. After all, he'd already seen Rouen more times than he could count.
Ned!
Anya hollered at the stills photographer who'd set his bags down and drifted away, snapping pictures of an artful mosaic pattern embedded in a bush-lined sidewalk. She and the rest of the Chasing History's Monsters crew stood outside the Val du Quinze, Julio César Ribeiro International Airport, a paved lot stretching in front of them, the city beyond it, and the river to the north. They were waiting for a van to whisk them to the docks. The area was crowded this morning, and she'd only moments ago watched airport security hustle away a young man who'd tried to steal a traveler's briefcase.
Ned, you better...
Too late. In a heartbeat, her photographer's leather satchel was scooped up. The thief swung it over her shoulder and dashed across the pavement, dodging cars as she went.
What? What's so... Hey, that's my stuff! Stop!
Anya hadn't waited for Ned Lundock. She'd shoved her own duffel into the arms of one of her crew and took off after the thief. Anya narrowly avoided becoming the hood ornament on a limo. She heard someone running behind her, but wasn't going to lose time to look over her shoulder to see who it was, and she wasn't about to lose sight of the satchel. She knew Ned had camera equipment in there that might be needed for their filming.
Ladrão!
Anya knew only a smattering of Portuguese, which had similarities to Spanish. She hoped she was hollering thief. She spotted people milling on the pavement ahead.
Ladrão! Impide-la!
But they didn't try to stop the young thief. They just stood and watched as both the girl and Anya raced by.
Pareo ladrón!
Anya spotted a taxi driver calling and waving to a police car on the far side of the lot, but the people in front of the girl seemed to jump out of the way rather than lend a hand and stop her. The thief, Anya only got a look at her backside, was probably in her early teens, wearing a t-shirt, jeans, and scuffed tennis shoes. She was nimble as a monkey, and fast. Anya was in top physical shape, but she wasn't catching up, just keeping pace. The girl had the satchel over one shoulder, and in the other hand she held a large leather clutch purse, probably also stolen. Clearing the pavement and the sidewalk beyond, the girl darted through traffic and headed into the city.
Anya matching her rapid rhythm. Whoever had been joining her in the chase gave up. Anya wasn't about to give up. The thief looked over her shoulder, and Anya caught a glimpse of her face. A kid, probably 12 or 13. The girl grinned widely, revealing the glint of braces on her teeth, and flipped Anya an obscene gesture. That only spurred Anya to dig down and lengthen her stride. She'd grown up in an orphanage and knew what poverty felt like. But this kid wasn't impoverished. Those braces had been paid for by the proceeds from petty thievery. The buildings that stretched ahead and above were a mix of modern skyscrapers and decades-old colonial charmers. All of it was a blur as Anya ran past business people heading to work and shopkeepers opening their stores. The thief exercised no care, rudely shoving folks, pulling some down in Anya's path to slow her. Finally, someone tried to lend a hand. A businessman at the next corner dropped his briefcase and made a grab for the girl. But she kicked his feet out from under him.
Thanks!
Anya leaped over the fallen man and gained a little ground on the girl, who had just gone down an alley that was too narrow for the police car to follow. Anya slipped through the gap between the buildings, continuing the mad dash after the thief.
Leave it for policia!
But Anya wasn't sure the policeman who had gotten out could catch the thief, who was now kicking up dirt and gravel in her dash.
This isn't a game!
There were two sets of feet approaching behind her. The police, Anya confirmed with a quick glance. Both of the officers were a tad on the pudgy side, and she doubted they could keep up. A park came into view, and Anya saw the girl sprinting across it, knocking a man with a cane to the ground. The girl had dropped the clutch purse somewhere and was swinging her free arm, feet chewing up clumps of grass. The park was a mistake for the thief. It let Anya lengthen her stride and close some of the distance. Anya jumped over a hedge and angled toward a fountain. Anya saw that one of the officers was still in the chase, but he was now 100 yards behind her. She changed directions to follow the girl, who just charged across one more street and into the Verupesu market. Fortunately, this early in the day, many of the vendors were still setting up, and the piles of boxes and carts that spread across the aisles made it impossible for the girl to race down any one path with a great amount of speed. The thief tried to push a cart out of the way, but was confronted by its vendor.
Qual è il problema?
The girl pushed him down, but that had cost her precious seconds. Anya was on the thief, sending her flying into a table with jewelry and brightly colored scarves. Shoppers gathered to see what the ruckus was, while angry vendors cursed and threw up their hands. Anya tugged the girl to her feet. The thief struggled, and for a brief instant, Anya got a glimpse of her sword in a deep, dark corner of her mind, as if it wanted to be called. But the thief was little more than a child. A nasty-tempered one, but a child.
Io so apenas una pobre, pobre garota!
Anya understood enough Portuguese to realize the girl was saying something about being just a poor, poor girl. And Anya was smart enough not to fall for it. With the girl's high-end Nikes, sterling silver belt buckle, and gold necklace, she probably wasn't poor. Her braces even had little gems set in them, like a rapper might have. She probably just stole for the rush, because she could get away with it. Anya passed the now cursing girl to the red-faced policeman. He handcuffed the girl, nodded to Anya, then bent and put his hands on his knees. In that instant, the girl tried to make a dash for it. But a tourist who had been shopping blocked her way.
I believe this belongs to you.
Carte! Caprado, caralho!
Obrigado! Thank you.
Anya picked up Ned's camera satchel and hoped nothing was broken inside.
Queixa?
Will you press charges, miss?
Sim. Yes, I most certainly will press charges.
Anya pulled out her cell phone.
Hi. Yeah, I caught up to her. Tell Ned I got his bag and never to leave it sitting around again. I don't care, he can't hear it enough. Look, tell everyone to get in the van and go get some breakfast. I'll meet up with you at the dock. There's no way of knowing how long the paperwork is going to take. Yeah, see you soon. Bye.
Arthur Dillon was the shopper who'd briefly held the thief.
He watched the officer prod the girl toward the police car, while the woman who'd caught her followed them. Dylan's companion drew his trench coat tight and adjusted his hat.
Blimey, a bit of excitement today. And with a celebrity, no less. The lovely lady who caught that thief. I see her on the telly every now and then. Do you follow it?
No, I don't watch TV much.
She's Anya Creed, a famous archaeologist. Chases mummies and the like. Did a special on vampiric goat suckers or some such in Mexico. I caught it the other day. I never go to Mexico because of that. Wonder what brings her to Brazil. What monsters might abound in the city, I wonder. I should have got closer, Artie. Asked you to take a picture of me and Anya Creed.
I don't have time for such nonsense, and you don't need any notoriety. I have to be on a helicopter at the airport in 2 hours.
And so you need your shopping to be all done with, I know. But did you have to drag me out here in the rain? I could have stayed in my nice warm flat.
It's the rainy season. I swear you won't melt. You said you had something to tell me.
Dylan checked off the items he'd already arranged for. A gallon jar of yucca pulp, dried choo-choo, and a couple of bags of oranges. He scanned the market for the rest. He spotted a tea and coffee vendor he favored and headed that way. Dylan could have placed his orders through a broker in the city, but he needed a brush with civilization every once in a while. The green of the rainforest became overpowering sometimes. He needed reliable Wi-Fi so he could see his emails and catch up on reading the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. He required an occasional stint in a 4-star hotel, a long soak in a hot tub, and female companionship that asked no questions and was willing to experiment if the money was right. Above all of that, he'd needed to meet with his British partner, who hadn't the mettle for venturing into the wild and was crucial to their endeavor.
So, a rather short stay then. Back to the salt mine, as the American expression goes.
Salt? Yes, so we have just enough time for coffee in our conversation.
Artie, everything we talked about yesterday morning, it's handled.
Already? I didn't think you'd get it locked down for a few days, at the earliest. I'm impressed.
I was lucky is all. Right people in the right places at the right time.
And?
The shipment we sent a few weeks back netted a tidy sum, all tucked away in the accounts, and got us more lookers for future deals. The next batches, we'd do better with that auction, I think.
Will that be difficult to arrange?
I've set that up, and we've a bidder already on the big one. More than one, I think, especially if we started low, say at 2. If we play it right, we should get twice that. How fast can we supply the smaller batches? I think I should cut some.
Tell them 3 weeks. That gives us a good margin. I have the other customers to handle in the meantime.
Yes. Those fellows in Atlanta and Dallas.
They are footing most of the bill for all of this.
And reaping only a smidgen of the reward.
The Brit raised his cup in a toast.
Thank God for nasty, incurable diseases, what?
It was almost noon when Anya reached the docks. Dealing with a few of the police department's Chasing History's Monsters fans meant she'd stuck around much longer than she expected. Fishermen were returning with an early morning catch, and sightseers of all nationalities abounded. The cloying odor of city traffic was replaced by the not-as-heavy scent of diesel fuel. The boat wasn't what she'd anticipated.
But I thought...
Ned practically flew toward her, snatched his satchel, and set her off balance. He caught her and tried to hug her.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, dear Anya. My lenses, my memory card, spare camera, waterproof camera.
You will never again leave your bag unattended in a big airport. Because I will not retrieve it for you a second time. You'll have to look through it to make sure nothing's damaged.
No, I certainly won't leave it unattended again. Seriously, thank you.
She wanted to be mad at him, but his boyish grin and sparkling blue eyes sunk that notion. Ned was new to her crew. He'd been picked up to shoot stills for the website. A photojournalist for a wire service, he'd spent 3 years in Afghanistan and Iraq, embedded with the troops, and had come back to the States a month ago when Chasing History's Monsters made him a lucrative enough offer to lure him away from hard news.
This isn't the right boat.
No, it's a better one.
This came from Wallace Carper, lead cameraman. Wallace was 62, twice Ned's age. His gray hair was short, and the hairless spot atop his head gleamed in the sun.
Thank heaven for sick Baptist ministers.
What?
Well, the so-called dependable boat that we booked, it had some serious engine problems, so Doug approved spending a little more and getting this. Not much choice, Miss Creed. Almost everything else is for tourists or is already rented. We lucked out with this baby. A group of Baptist ministers from Georgia had her booked for a 2-week retreat, but they all got the flu and canceled this very morning. Lucky, huh?
I suppose. I guess we could use this for a while and...
Already paid for 2 weeks. Doug wired the money. We're getting a refund for the broken one.
This one isn't as sleek as the one we'd planned on, Wall.
Look, it was this or wait around for who knows how long until something else opened up. But I'm liking this boat. Come on, Miss Creed, I'll give you the tour. I already put your duffel in your cabin. Gave you the nicest one.
Cabin?
Anya had expected to be roughing it. This series was wholly her idea, and she'd thought taking the antique-looking tug she had chartered through the tributaries would come over great on film, making the segments look dangerous. Wallace led the way on board the luxury liner.
According to the captain, Oriana's prize is one of the oldest vessels still navigating the Amazon. Maybe the oldest, built in France in 1876.
Anya felt a tingle on the back of her neck. Rue had called her from France this morning, said he was thinking of her. Odd connection, this boat, to France. They circled the deck. Anya put the boat at a little more than 90 feet long and 16 or 17 feet wide. It had two upper levels, giving it the look of a Mississippi riverboat, and the roof served as a viewing area, complete with safety rail and padded benches.
We each have our own cabin, air-conditioned, private bathrooms with showers, and there's a big dining room, and off in a library.
A library?
Anya did the math. The boat had at least 6 private cabins for guests, because counting herself, there was 6 in the film crew. Wallace, Ned, a second videographer, Marcia Carr, logistics, Ken McCullough, and sound, Amanda Hill. Somewhere between Anya's shower, she needed it, and washing her sweaty clothes, they had a laundry machine aboard, Oriana's prize had taken off. Wallace had told the captain that they were all set once Anya rejoined the group, and then had told the cook to fix them some grub. Anya picked up her satellite phone off the nightstand. She figured Doug wanted to make sure they were underway.
Rue? What's going on?
2 calls in one day was unusual for him, even if he wasn't the most usual person.
Rue!
I was thinking of you.
Yeah, that's what you said when you called this morning.
And everything is still fine?
Anya talked while she dressed, shifting the phone from one hand to the other as she wriggled into her jeans.
Yeah, sure. Other than this boat being a little too lavish and me being too accepting... My jog through the downtown resulted in my getting a private bath with a shower and a closet. I wasn't here to pick a different boat.
A different boat?
Never mind. You don't know what I'm talking about. What's this about, Rue? What's going on?
Probably nothing.
Probably? Are you still in Rouen?
Still France.
That's where this boat was made.
Pardon?
The boat I'm on, Oriana's prize. Named for a drowned man, Francisco de Oriana. He was a Spanish soldier, the first European to explore the river. He helped Pizarro conquer Peru and even served as a governor. He returned to Spain with tales of gems, spices, and native women resembling Greek mythological Amazons. Eventually he came back here, but his ship capsized at the mouth and he drowned. A boat named after a drowned man. Who would do that? And paint the name in the color of blood?
Anya paused, waiting for him to continue talking. The back of her neck tingled. Something was amiss. She slipped on a light overshirt and buttoned the sleeves at her wrists.
Are we done with this conference?
I'm at Charles de Gaulle Airport, Anya. There wasn't a direct flight from Rouen.
Direct flight?
To Belém.
Rue, what is going on?
Probably nothing, Anya, as I said. I'm probably being a silly old man.
You got the old man part down.
Watch yourself, all right?
Always.
This boat that you're...
Oriana's prize. It's not waiting for you, Rue. I felt it leave the dock. Flying to Belen is a waste of your time and money. You're probably not going to be able to catch up with us, let alone find us. The Amazon is a big, big river.
It wasn't cheap, the flight. 1,500 euros for an open return ticket, and that was for a seat in coach.
Anya's brows knitted together. Rue had a bad feeling about something if he was willing to sit in coach for an international flight. And giving her that tidbit about the cost was his way of telling her to worry.
I'm fine, Rue. The boat's fine. Whatever your intuition is telling you, it's off the mark. But yeah, I'll watch myself.
Anya put the phone down and sat on her bed, head in her hands.
Ugh, I don't need this.
Rue chasing her down the Amazon? It irritated her that the old man just showed up unannounced sometimes, even if it was usually with the intention of helping her. She closed her eyes and searched for the sword, finding it in the otherwhere. She wasn't going to need her sword on this trip. Or was she? She shook off the thought, instead heading to the dining room. She hoped lunch was something significant. Her stomach was rumbling like crazy. When Anya met the captain...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.